Are your thoughts inside your mind, wanting to be free?
You are responsible for the period of history that you are living in.
A new research study is illustrating a startling new trend with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD.
The number of kids diagnosed with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD, is going up.
According to new research, the diagnosis of ADHD is up by 25% over the past decade.
These are really bright kids that don't fit in the box.
Since knowledge is infinite, it is infinite.
So my name is Gordon Fisher, and this is my film about learning differences.
One day, right before Gordon entered his senior year, he was sitting in the kitchen where our computer is, and I was cooking or something, and he said, "Mom, come and look at this. Come and look at this list. I think I have all these symptoms." I said, "What are you talking about?" I had no idea what he was researching.
And I typed in ADHD and I found a list of symptoms, and it said forgetful, doesn't pay attention to class, daydreams in class, doesn't turn in assignments on times, is disruptive, and I was all of those things.
And I looked at this list and I thought, I definitely agreed with him. So he basically diagnosed himself, and I immediately made an appointment with a local doctor who his field is working with adolescents who have ADHD, and he has all the tests. He put Gordon through the proper testing, and we have the report. Here's his report, which is several pages, about 8 pages long, going step by step through the diagnosis of his disorder. It's called, it's actually technically called attention deficit hyperactivity disorder inattentive type.
I have ADHD. My whole college career has been this big journey, this exploration into what are learning differences? What does my ADHD mean for me? What is it? How does it impact my education? How does it impact my mind? What is my mind? What is consciousness?
I begin to think of what is learning? What is education? What is the point of this school? Why am I different? What am I different from? What's the norm? What's the status quo? Then I started studying education more, and I see that the whole school system is designed on the factory model system. Like the same ideology as the Industrial Revolution of training a lot of people to do certain tasks in a certain way in the most efficient way. Build the most products, you know, to be able to sell the most. So the school system was designed.
I daydream in class all day. I was diagnosed a certain type of student. It was even called disability. Point is to explore what is this concept of learning differences. Concept of learning differences. Concept of learning differences.
So he has an inattentive disorder. And so our next step was to put him on, this doctor and his own, Gordon's own doctor, were recommending that he should be on medication. That was very hard for me. It was also very hard for Gordon's dad, for both of us, to have to put a child on medication. And we seriously considered not doing it. We felt that we should at least give Gordon the chance to see what the medication did. He was put on the lowest possible dose of Vyvanse.
So I started taking the pills at age 17, and I immediately noticed I could stay focused in class,
started forgetting things less. I could sit for hours
so,
doing my homework.
I was diagnosed with ADHD and then prescribed this medication. It was recommended I try this stuff called Vyvanse. And
doctor said try
I tried it, and for 1 week
it.
I was depressed. And then it was strange to be on this. I was thinking differently.
It did.
And then
I did observe.
I got used to it, and then suddenly I realized I was focused in class. I was taking notes. I was intensely
creative, and I could write for hours.
Drifting off. I wasn't
working.
Sitting there doing nothing, doing but everything. I took them all through college until 2 months ago when I started making this film. I guess I felt it was time to stop.
ADHD is a difference in cognition, not simply a disorder. We are attention different, not attention deficit. But because it is treated and misunderstood as a disorder, it's treated as something that needs fixing. So the idea seems to be that we need to get rid of my ADHD. But there's no getting rid of it, there's just sedating it.
There are now very, very young people of 5 years or 4 years taking pills because they think they have learning differences. Oh, which is the name of your...
ADHD.
ADHD, which I think is something that never exists. The only problem about this, how can you call it again?
ADHD.
ADHD is that probably you move a lot or you have a very high creativity or you are very intelligent people, so you don't want to be in a classroom 8 hours sitting down in a desk. You have to move when you are 5 years old. You have to move all the time because your body is asking for that. So schools are really like jails.
He was extremely adorable, but also extremely frustrating at times. But he was also extremely creative and intense. And his Lego masterpieces were incredible concoctions that went on for days. He also started to play basketball, and that was a great way to release this pent-up energy. So as he grew older in middle school and then in high school, he became a huge basketball star. And we were all very proud of him, and it kind of overshadowed any other, for better or for worse, it overshadowed any problems.
Somehow I was able to get by throughout my elementary, middle school, and high school careers because I could get around the system. And in making this film, I'm trying to explore what that diagnosis of ADHD meant for me and how it has changed who I am.
I'm breaking the fourth wall.
So here I am, a freshman at Colby College, and I've just been diagnosed with ADHD. And this is a label given to me by a psychological test. And I didn't really know what it meant.
All right. ADHD is a neurobehavioral disorder that is characterized mainly by inattention, kind of like problems with paying attention or daydreaming a lot, not being able to focus, as well as... hyperactivity or overactivity, kind of like not being able to sit still, fidgeting a lot, that kind of stuff, or impulsivity.
I found that I was also in a system that said I have learning disabilities, that the social category for people with ADHD is called learning disabilities, or someone said I have learning disabilities, or that I learn that I have a learning difference. So I'm making this film about learning differences.
Mm-hmm.
From your perspective, can you define what are learning differences?
Yeah.
For someone who might not know about
it. Right. The way I would define learning differences, it's a cognitive difference in how a person processes information. I mean, different from whatever we consider to be average or normal.
Learning differences is kind of this big umbrella term that a lot of different disorders and disabilities are kind of lumped into. Another aspect of learning differences is the way people learn. So some people are auditory learners, other people are visual learners. And the thing is, in the institution that we're at, whereas higher education in general, it might not cater to an individual's way of learning, thus making it very difficult for them.
What is a learning difference? How would you describe what that is?
A learning difference, a learning difference is like, pretty much there is a set way of
teaching.
I guess there's like just a general way of
usually,
teaching, right? It's like
I think there's
like
a set curriculum, right?
Like in a school, it's almost like a factory.
You just don't learn that
and
way.
They have like a particular curriculum that they teach.
Because they have a different way of learning from everyone else, which is, I guess, not normal.
In an academic context, learning differences are usually encompass ways that students learn that don't kind of fit the norm.
Norm.
But we work to this thing called the average or the norm. And so that's the expectation that education and a lot of other things, you know, in society in general are built around. What's the average person supposed to be able to do? And let's focus on that. Let's create structures that address that.
So that makes me question about that structure and that norm.
Mm-hmm.
How do we determine sort of what's normal?
It's a statistical term that gets misused in terms of an expectation that everybody is sort of the same.
One type of learning, therefore, is acknowledged, appreciated, celebrated, supported, etc. And that's the kind of learning, how can I articulate it?
I think that's probably fair to say that for the most part, the model we've had is what did our Frere call it?
A banking kind of model for
pouring
learning.
Information into an empty mind.
True, false, multiple choice, matching or completion.
Asking for withdrawals to see if it's still there.
And sometimes there are some students that just don't fit with that, you know? They're not like really programmed to like fit that certain curriculum. And those kids have a tough time trying to get through, so.
I think it's important for people to recognize that, you know, having a learning disability isn't something that you cash in when it's useful. It's a reality of your life, and it impacts all arenas of it. And at times it can impact everything, the social, the academic, the, you know, your personal belief in regards for yourself. And I just think it's important that people are sensitive and aware of those issues.
I am an undiagnosed ADD person. My brother has a severe version of it. My son has a severe version of it. The effects it had on me were quite, there was a lot of shame involved in it, and shaming. So this translated into the label that I was lazy. And there was an enormous divergence between my IQ and what I was achieving, quote-unquote, in the classroom.
You know, just like there's different kinds of people, you know, different personalities. People learn different. And I feel like, I guess, in this society that we're living in, there's only one way of learning.
to make us the fools.
I found that a lot of the times people's knowledge was limited, and it was limited to the when it became visible, and the only time it became visible is when students might receive extra time on tests, and they're not taking the test in the same room. But I felt like a lot of the times the struggle and the challenges that come with it are not seen to the average student who doesn't have those challenges.
Learning difference becomes a problem because everybody has to go through schools. Everybody has to get a degree. And in order to get a decent income just to live, you have to go through these loops. And sadly, schools are just not designed for everybody. And so some highly intelligent people, some highly creative people, some highly individual, independent people fall through that loop. They struggle.
I don't know if the administration or the campus knows how much of an issue this is for a lot of students on campus.
At Colby, there's no formal program for students with learning differences.
I am support services, and that is a portion of my total job.
Your roles are?
So I have several roles. I'm an assistant dean of students. I'm an advising dean. I'm a mentor to POSSE students. I also have a title of coordinator of multicultural students and programs. That's kind of what I took on when I came over to work with the POSSE program, and also coordinator of support services. 90 to 95% of the accommodations awarded by this office are extra time on exams, and graded in-class assignments. I would say we're probably more toward the back of the line than the front of the line. And I think largely that is because we have always been an institution that has been very tight staff. That's been the idea. The way the budget and economics are managed are in a very conservative manner.
A lot of students who have been able to be successful in high school because they had a support system that helped them negotiate their learning difference, they come here and they find that system isn't really in place. It's very minimal.
Can I honestly say that we have good services in place for that? Absolutely not. I think that discourages students from wanting to be the one that's going to be the pioneer that's going to bring Colby up to the standards where they would like to go to school.
Well, one of the reasons that I'm here is because I've been having some indications that I might learn in different ways, like having learning differences.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
I have no idea if I have something or not.
Right.
And I would like to know how could I ever know if I have something.
Yeah. So the proper way to move forward and sort of understand
mm-hmm.
what the issues might be, and also be able to have documentation of that to present to someone so they can assist you with those,
mm-hmm.
is to get what's known as an educational psychological evaluation.
Mm-hmm. And do you know about the cost of this test?
It can be expensive. In this area,
mm-hmm.
it costs about $100 an hour, and the test is $500 to $600. Average.
Okay.
I have seen tests go up to $1,000.
I think we have many, many people who might have learning differences and who are not diagnosed. And they're not diagnosed because their parents don't have $600 or $1,000.
Scientific tests prove. Let your own taste be the judge. Prove to yourself what scientific tests prove.
Okay, so given your background in developmental psychology, how do you perceive intelligence testing?
I'm pretty critical of the intelligence testing industry. Mainly because intelligence tests are defined and designed to test in a standard way. So one form of testing that's supposed to work for everyone. But the reality is there's really not a way to get a large group of people together in a room and test them and treat them all the same. It's not possible.
Every student with learning differences works and excels and suffers and struggles in different ways, and it's hard to know and understand what support and services can be provided because nothing's going to help everyone.
We must begin to reprogram our thought from how we were taught back in school and on our TV screen.
What's that?
This says art. It's just some work that Gordy's done at college. Color. He really likes collage. This is some of the collages that he made of people that have influenced him, events. I think collage is the closest thing to making a film because you can just bring so many different ideas and thoughts and mediums onto a surface. I'm not sure what this is, but...
So we're in here in the lab with Adam D. Thompson. We're working on, what's this program?
Ableton Live 8.
And what are we doing here?
Right now we're just taking sounds from recordings that we've done together, interviews, and basically extracting clips that we like, running them through processors, and then manipulating them with this keyboard. And hopefully arriving at a product that sounds like a bit of a mosaic, a bit of a, you know,
an amalgamation of sound.
Right, just
a pastiche.
Trying to elicit some emotion.
Almost a visual collage.
Yeah.
Of this concept of learning differences, learning differences.
But most of all, the point is to explore what is this concept of learning differences.
We often operate as though there was only one way of learning, or there's only one kind of student who's normal, who is successful. And the truth of the matter is, and we all know this, that there are lots of learning styles, and there are lots of ways to be brilliant. And there are people who may have one particular kind of issue, whether it's neurological or whatever it might be, that means they can't learn in a particular way. That doesn't mean they can't learn.
One of the most important challenges is to give the public, society, the information that we now possess that shows it is never about intelligence when we're talking about things like these learning or reading differences. It's about different ways the brain's organized. Now, the world still believes that if you can't read, or you can't do your math, or you can't write or spell, you're dumb. What is dumb is that they don't understand the brain. You don't want to call anyone dumb, but you especially don't want to call anyone dumb who could be your next Leonardo da Vinci or Edison or Picasso or the string of dyslexic entrepreneurs, geniuses, inventors, etc.
I think I'm pretty sure Einstein had some problem in elementary school. Which was whatever subject, I don't remember. Einstein had problem, I know for sure. And I also know quite a few artists and very successful people.
And the other thing that's been good, and probably why I ended up being a poet, is that when you have ADD, the linear thought processes are not, don't have the same hold, although, you know, quite capable of linear thought processes. But the, and what you might call logic, but there's another sideways activity which I would refer to as analogical thinking or associative thinking, so that one thing makes you think, oh, I wonder about this related thing. And when you're wondering about what the related thing is, you can contextualize different facts in richer ways. And it interferes with getting your assignments done on time.
But on the other hand, to have the so-called learning difference in college, I think, speaking from my experience working with other people who have learning difference, is that you really have to turn inward to look for inner resource.
Since knowledge is infinite, it has infinitely failed.
I think if there's any one term that I want to use with reading differences and dyslexia, it's a very unusual term called cerebrodiversity. And by that we mean that our human brain has been relatively the same for the last 40, 50,000 years ago. In other words, before the species ever invented reading, that brain was there for a reason. So the diversity is the diversity needed for the species to be able to do all the things we need to do to survive. So the person with dyslexia, for example, is quite often a person with a brain organization that advantages them for building, for art, for architecture, for seeing the big patterns, for thinking outside the box. That brain has been there before reading was ever invented. That reading was there with all its intelligence for reasons that are important to the species. Now, so what we have to do is completely separate our notions of intelligence from learning and reading differences, because those brains were always with us for very important reasons. And what has happened over the last 100, 200 years is that we didn't understand that it was our inability to teach that brain. We didn't know how. It's not so much a learning difference, really, ultimately. It's a lack of knowledge about how to teach that brain organization in the way it needs.
Wow. We're at a point today where our professors should be educated about learning differences, what they are, and how they affect students, and kind of what they need to do, what they, being the professors, need to do to assist their students and provide support for them.
I think that for professors, their background really impacts the way in which they, how they treat students with learning disabilities. I had one professor who had a daughter of her own with a learning disability, and so she was very empathetic and willing and understanding in terms of my strengths and weaknesses. I think that some professors don't have as much knowledge or background, and I think it's a little more challenging figuring out what it means to still have a high bar for a student while also recognizing that they learn differently or that they have different needs.
A lot of this is relatively new. Like 20 years ago, learning differences, there wasn't much to them. No one really knew about them. And so for professors, that's hard because they're not used to this, and all of a sudden, they've always had kids who've struggled. And so they're like, why are these students any different? And the thing is, it's been there all along. It's just now we're realizing that we have the potential to allow everyone to succeed, and we need to do that.
I heard about this student named Gordon. How do you know Gordon?
Well, Gordon appeared in my Intro to American Studies, I think in his sophomore year. And he was such an interesting student, and I think he liked the class. And so he came back for more, and he took another class with me in his junior year. And so I got to know him because he was thinking about the American Studies major as one of his possibilities.
Okay, and then you became his advisor?
I became his advisor because he declared the American Studies major on the basis of some conversations that we'd had. But it soon became clear to me that Gordon wasn't going to be an American Studies major, and we had to figure out what we were going to do about that.
Because part of what was good about American Studies for Gordon is it's interdisciplinary. It lets you do a lot of different things, and it gives you a lot of options within a set of required courses. You have a lot of choices, and so it seemed like it was the right thing for him because his interests are so diverse.
As I chose classes, I found I was interested in a variety of topics, a multiplicity of different academic subjects. And I took classes in philosophy, anthropology, sociology, art history, African history, African American history, American studies, history of social movements, Marxism. I studied hip hop on my own. I took creative writing. I studied English. I studied history. I studied astronomy. I'm interested in gaining knowledge. I'm interested in seeing the connections between these different subjects. And this is what I think makes the most sense to me. So when I came time to choose a major, I really, really struggled.
It was so interesting to be working with Gordon as his advisor because we would sit down and we would plan the courses that he was going to take to proceed with the American Studies major, and he'd go off and register for a whole bunch of different courses. And I'd look at what he did online and I'd think, and I'd send him an email and say, Gordon, these look like great courses, but they're not actually going to help you complete the American Studies major. And he would write back and say, yeah, I know, but I'm so interested in, in political theory or in anthropology or, I'm just really, really interested in these things. And so after a while, I realized his interests are too diverse. I mean, he's this incredibly voracious reader. He's just interested in so many things. He can't really not go pursue things that interest him. And so he's so much an autodidact in many, many fields, but he's interested in so many things that even something as expansive as American Studies couldn't really capture how many things he was interested in.
The more you realize that you have these arbitrary thought processes which are underlain by a unitary awareness, which is nameless and non-intellectual, the more you can integrate the conventional world with this holistic way of perceiving the universe.
Yo, 5:36 a.m. Just up to see the sunrise again. I've been up all night editing that film that you are watching right now. What do you think of it? Are you learning differently now?
So we have to recreate ourselves in order to recreate our world. Come on.
Everybody realized that the old frameworks and values on which they depended perhaps for generations were collapsing.
My experience with ADD really began to take a turn when I started acknowledging that I must gain knowledge of self, and I'm the only one who can do that. And so I began reading.
So you're a philosopher?
Yes. 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 I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply.
In about 4 seconds, a teacher will begin to speak.
I think very deeply.
In the absolute sense, there are no gaps. Everything is uniform. So, that dovetail a bit with my analogical feeling, my analogical thinking that I discussed earlier, with the intuition that everything connected.
So you see that learning differences is connected to a greater problem of educational reform.
Yeah, I think it has this bridge, and this movement of educational reform is now getting bigger and bigger. There is a lot of TED Talks and a lot of people talking about we need to make an education revolution, what I call the redubolution, so the revolution in education settings.
We have to think differently about human capacity. We have to get over this old conception of academic, non-academic.
It's very important to recognize that we are in an unusual moment in our history. our research has enabled us to literally look inside the brain of our children and our individuals with learning and reading and math differences. And what we find is really a stunning and exciting area in which we see, especially in the area that I know best, that is reading differences, we see a right hemisphere that is very advantaged for all these various things that we've been discussing, like art and architecture and pattern differences and these thinking outside the box talents and capacities. But it's disadvantaged for the language processes that go in the left hemisphere. What you see is literally that brain is advantaged for some areas. That's why it's here. It's disadvantaged for some of the areas that are cultural inventions that are relatively new. Reading is 5,500 years old. It's nothing. It's a blink of the eye in evolutionary terms.
By definition, someone with a learning difference has average or above average intelligence. So it's not an issue of intelligence, it's an issue of processing information within the structure that is education, you know, traditionally.
Okay.
And the other thing that I found and observed in the many students I've had who have had learning differences, whether it's dyslexia or ADD or Tourette's or whatever, is that when you work with that disability and you find a way to live with it and work through it to get to what you're supposed to be understanding in school, that effort and this sort of cross-contextualization that's always happening in your mind means that what you do learn means more and becomes much more of an organic part of your sensibility.
But no matter what you say, you will never get enough support and practical help to go through all these hurdles. So you really have to tap into your inner resource, which is a bless, you know? So I think Gordon is one of those people, you know? He had to struggle, and so he had to look inside, you know. We had lots of discussion about Buddha's teachings, you know. And he really, really was drawn to it, you know. Very, very inquisitive, very, very thoughtful, and take it in, right? You know. So I think he was very successful in terms of not to identify himself with that label. It's just a label.
You know, Gordon actually couldn't get on track. That's what I finally realized. He just couldn't do it. And so it was ridiculous to try to force him into some box that he really couldn't go into and that was actually going to limit his education rather than allow him to grow in all the ways he could. And so finally it occurred to me, this man needs an independent major. And so he and I sat down and talked about that. We talked about what he was really interested in. We talked about the courses that he'd taken. We looked at what he had. He'd actually pursued a set of interests that were quite coherent, but he hadn't exactly done it in a deliberate way. And when we looked at what he'd done, we thought, well, if we just add a few more courses and build on certain things, then we have a really coherent and interesting independent major. And he went off and wrote the proposal, and it was just totally brilliant. You know, he really talked about the ways that the system of education that we have is too constraining. And for somebody like him in particular, he literally could not do the things that we required him to do. They were antithetical to his very being.
After experimenting in a variety of different fields and finding that I couldn't pick one to choose as a major, I decided to make my own major, which is called Art and Social Justice, which encompasses art classes, film classes, creative writing classes, and also sociology, government, political theory, American studies, philosophy. Let me remind you that those are not the only subjects that I study. Those are just the ones that blended nicely and fit for a good title of my major, which accurately represents who I am. I use art for social justice. That's what I do.
I really think that people with learning differences are people which fight the power. And I really think that that's something that I will encourage all my students to do, you know, because it is related with critical thinking.
In regards to, like, why do we have all these learning differences all of a sudden? Learning differently from what? Like, the norm?
The one thing that I have told audience after audience of educators around this country and actually around many countries is that it is never the case that a system that we have in place now was ever an appropriate one for a child or an individual with learning difference. It simply wasn't tailored for them at all. And it's never the way that that person learns. It's how do we teach that person to develop and release their potential. That's the job of a teacher, not to grade.
A lot of teachers, they look like they are teaching, and the students, they look like they are learning, but learning is not happening. Because everything is obsessed with evaluation and, marks, and if they get an A or a B or a C, but learning is not happening. It's what I call the bulimic process. You know, this process about eating information, just throwing it up in the exam, and when you finish the exam, you forget everything you have in your mind.
Okay, what does it say about Gordon that he is ranked 456 out of 503 students in his class?
Well, if anything proved the idiocy of class rank, that fact does it, right? Gordon is one of the smartest students in his class. Like, you know, I know a lot of these students. I think he's really, really, really smart. But what that grade point average registers is that the system cannot actually accommodate different kinds of learners. You know, what class rank marks is the people who are really good at doing exactly what we require of them. And lots of students can't do that. And that's not about how smart they are or how accomplished they are. That's about a really mechanical way of measuring something that cannot be measured.
To realize that life without knowledge is death in disguise.